Hello, and welcome to Clearer Thinking with Spencer Greenberg, the podcast about ideas that matter. I'm Josh Castle. I'm the producer of the podcast, and I'm so glad you've joined us today. In this episode, Spencer speaks with Jeremy Stevenson about meditation. They discuss Jeremy's journey with meditation. They examine various definitions of words like meditation, mindfulness, enlightenment, and other related concepts. And they talk about a project they're working on together to map out all the different techniques, skills, and insights related to meditation.
Jeremy, welcome.
Hey, thanks for having me on.
Yeah, it's great to have you on. So Jeremy and I have been collaborating on a project where we've been investigating topics in meditation. And basically our goal has been to try to understand all the different things that could be called meditation, all the different skills involved, all the different insights that meditation might be able to help people with. And so today I'm really excited to kind of explore these topics with Jeremy and also to hear about his journey in terms of exploring meditation on its own over the last few years.
Yeah, that sounds really good to me. Cool.
Awesome. So Jeremy, do you want to first start by just mentioning how we met?
Yeah, I was just keen to tell this story because I thought it was just funny and strange. But yeah, I had heard of you through different podcasts and a friend of mine. I was trying to make a decision on which postgrad course to do. And I was basically just paralyzed by the decision. And I think a friend of me sent a blog post you wrote about how to make difficult decisions. And so that was my introduction to you. And I really liked it. And I kind of categorized your style of work as non-bullshit self-help. In contrast to all the bullshit self-help out there.
Thanks, I appreciate that.
Because it's actually got substance and it's got concrete take-home points. So anyway, I think a few years passed and I would listen to you on podcasts every now and then. And then, yeah, fast forward to this year, I was just talking to a friend about the problem of relationship dissatisfaction and how I thought it was kind of strange how no one's really built good apps for this problem, as far as I've seen anyway. And so, yeah, I just randomly decided to send you a message through your website, and I had to condense it to only a small amount of characters because I was blabbering. And yeah, you got back in touch, I think it was probably pretty quickly. And yeah, you just said by coincidence, you and your team had been talking about three different ideas of online tools you could build. And one of them was for relationships. And so you replied, and then I don't know how this happened, but then you also shared that the second idea you were talking about was self-compassion. And then I was like, shit, well, I did my PhD in self-compassion. So I replied to you saying that. And then it was just such a big coincidence that at that point you suggested we have a phone chat. So we organized that. And that was like, from my perspective, that was under the premise that we'd be chatting about, you know, self-compassion or relationship stuff. And then I was telling you about the meditation experience I've had. And then we just spoke about that like the whole time. And then, but by another huge coincidence is that you were looking for someone to work on a meditation project. And I was looking for work. And so, yeah, that's how we connected. And yeah, it's been like half a year now. So I just thought it was a really strange series of coincidences how we connected in the first place.
Yeah, it's really awesome and amazing how many interests we have in common. So I think we should talk about all of those things today. meditation, yeah. Self-compassion, and possibly relationships as well. One mm-hmm. of the things that really fascinated me about you is that it's clear that the way you think about meditation is as a way to improve yourself and as a journey that you're trying to explore and actually figure out what's true, what's not true, what works, you know, what's bullshit. And I really respect that way of thinking about it. And so do you want to tell us a little bit about your meditation journey as you've explored this topic?
Yeah, for sure. Well, I've always been interested in self-help and I knew what meditation was, but it was only when I started to see, you know, I'm just one of those suckers that got pulled in by the neuroscience research. Like as soon as I saw that it could change your brain, I was like, oh, I have to start doing this thing. So I started to dabble a little bit and I got more into it when I started listening to Sam Harris talk about it, and he wrote his book, Waking Up, and did a few talks on it. And just led me to do my first retreat. And so I sat a 5-day retreat in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition. And it was pretty profound. I just got like a lot of benefits out of it. I did not like the technique they were teaching.
What was it? What was the technique?
I mean, there was a range of different things, but one of them was like, from memory, it was like holding one nose closed on the inhale and then opening that nostril on the exhale. Mm-hmm. And it just seemed a bit too finicky for me. And so it was kind of an empowering retreat because I ended up using my own technique that I got from acceptance and commitment therapy. And I didn't realize this was a technique that you find in other traditions of Buddhism, but it was labeling. So whenever I would have a thought, I would label it. So like planning, worrying, catastrophizing, blah, blah, blah. And that doing that technique allowed me to have my first like solid experience of just getting distance from my thoughts and feeling separate. And it just felt really good. And then after that retreat, I just felt like I had a type of well-being that I hadn't really tasted before, where I just felt calm and great and at peace without anything happening in a way.
How long did that feeling last?
probably like 3 weeks, maybe 2 weeks. So not very long. And another frustrating thing I remember is I was really excited about learning how to be mindful of thoughts, and that faded as well. I remember like after 2 weeks trying to do noting of thoughts, and I just didn't have the concentration. I would just get completely lost in thought and didn't know what I was doing. But regardless, I had a taste of something, and then I was really keen to continue. So
one of the things that I really like about the way you think about meditation is that I think like me, you view it as a set of psychological techniques rather than as sort of some tradition that needs to be followed, you know, to the letter. And because with that mindset of viewing it as a set of psychological techniques, then we can ask questions like, well, which techniques should we try? And maybe we should mix techniques. Maybe that will be better than just using one technique. And, you know, what's the more efficient way to achieve a particular goal, which kind of has led to the project we're working on together. Would you agree with that? That's how you think about it?
Yeah. I mean, I wasn't clear about that when I first started. I remember sitting on that first retreat and thinking like, what the hell am I doing here? I didn't know what the goal was. And I'd heard of like Sam Harris talking about, you know, the technique he talks about of non-dual mindfulness or self-transcending at will. And, you know, I'd be trying to do that and there's no hope. I've just got no idea what he's talking about. But definitely these days I think about it more in those terms, you know, and you can think about it as an emotion regulation strategy. And yeah, different types of meditation have different goals, and different retreats I've done have different goals. And I have some regrets over spending too much time on certain techniques when I think I would have been better off doing other techniques that would have been more useful for normal life.
I think that some of the things that bog people down when they're trying to learn about meditation is that, first of all, they can get stuck in very dogmatic viewpoints where, you know, they'll have a particular teacher that says, this is the only way to meditate and you have to do it like this. And maybe that people have been doing that for 1,000 years and maybe that works great for them, but it doesn't necessarily work well for everyone. And so I think that's one kind of trap people have. Another, I think, really a big challenge people have is that a lot of times meditation is taught with very obscure seeming language. So it's very hard to understand what people are talking about. And sometimes it sounds like it's almost nonsense. And sometimes it sounds like it's almost just saying something that's obvious. And, you know, and you're kind of like, well, is there something deep here? Is there not? And so one thing I would like to do with you today is explore how you really think about what meditation is and try to cut through a lot of this BS and really get to the core of like, what is it about? What are the kinds of things that it's really doing? And what are the different approaches or ways of looking at it? So let's get back to that in a little while. But in the meantime, I want to hear more about your journey. So you did this 5-day retreat. You had these benefits. They faded. What happened next?
Yeah. So I kept meditating in my own time. And then I was doing research on where else I could do retreats. And yeah, I discovered a secular organization in Adelaide, in Australia, where I live. And yeah, I roped a friend of mine into doing it. And yeah, we went and sat a really relaxed, more conventional retreat, but with a lot of meditation in it as well. And yeah, that just continued to spur me on. And in that retreat, I had a really, my first really profound experience, like an altered state of consciousness, where I was doing walking meditation across this soft carpeted meditation room. And then it's a distant memory now, but I just kind of got overwhelmed by the profundity of just staring at my hand. I was just blown away by it. It's almost like what a stone would do, but it felt much more clear than that. And it was just a profound experience of well-being, and it seemed to carry like a lesson with it. Like, people do so much in life in terms of traveling to the edges of the world to find a sense of meaning, but it can be discovered just by searching inside your own mind. So that was interesting. And then I also, for the first time, had an experience of fear pretty soon after that.
A fear?
Yeah, I got kind of anxious. I didn't know why.
But it happened during meditation?
Yeah, I think it did happen. I think it just happened in between sessions. Like, after that session, I just got kind of hit with a bit of existential anxiety. And I went and spoke to the teacher, and I was kind of imagining I was the first person on earth to get anxious from meditation. And she just was not phased at all, and just said it's a pretty normal thing, and it happens, and some people think it's a stage, and then it faded and I felt better again. So
what kind of techniques were you using in that retreat? How long was the retreat, and how many hours a day were you meditating?
That retreat was really flexible. You like, I think I only had like 3 formal sessions, and they were pretty good in terms of teaching a range of different techniques, but the 2 main ones were mindfulness and compassion. But yeah, they would teach a range of different types of mindfulness, like the focused attention and then open awareness. So they were just kind of giving us an introduction to different types.
So this might be a good time, since you use the term mindfulness. I think this is a great example of a term that's often thrown around, and very often it's used imprecisely and people don't really know what is being talked about. So how would you define the different components of mindfulness?
Yeah, so this is something we've been working on a bit in our project, and from reading loads and loads of definitions, to me it seems like the best definition of mindfulness in its most typical sense is 2 components. One is an attitude of equanimity. So it basically means you've got an equal acceptance of both pleasant and unpleasant and neutral experiences. So you're not pushing away unpleasant experiences or pulling and trying to keep and hold on to pleasant experiences. That's one.
Right, so no craving and no aversion, right?
Exactly, so it kind of covers that component of it. And then the second is a meta-awareness. So this is kind of being aware of what you're aware of, or knowing that you're, kind of knowing what you're doing. And that kind of subsumes the presence component that we've spoken about before, because a lot of people use mindfulness almost as there's heaps of definitions, and some people use it just as a synonym for being present, but it's not the classical and most common definition of mindfulness, because, you know, animals are present, they're not lost in thought, but we wouldn't call them mindful. So I think a meta-awareness captures it better.
Right. So just to give some examples of things that like might sound like mindfulness, but would not be according to that definition. So if you are, let's say, just being present, let's say you're walking through nature and you're really aware of the trees around you and how beautiful they are, that's not mindfulness, because you're not aware of the fact that you're paying attention to the trees. Is that right?
Yeah, exactly. That's how I'll distinguish it. So you can kind of distinguish between a nice flow state where, you're really present, or you're surfing or in nature or whatever. But yeah, there isn't that meta-awareness of knowing what you're actually aware of.
Right. And similarly, let's say you're like eating really tasty food and you're like focused on the food, and you're also focused on the fact that you're focused on the food. So you're meta-aware, but you're like, this is so good, this is amazing. That's also not mindfulness by that definition, because you don't have the equanimity part, right?
Yeah, agree. You're missing that component.
Right. So I think that's really cool. So it's equanimity and the meta-awareness. So awareness of the awareness, right?
Yeah.
Cool. Great. Okay, that's excellent. And then you used another term, which is compassion. Yeah. And I suppose you're specifically talking about compassion meditation. Is that right?
Yeah.
So how would you define compassion meditation?
Yeah, the most common definition of compassion I see, and kind of the most basic definition is the desire for another conscious creature to feel better or to have their suffering reduced. And some people add in that there's a motivational component there as well, like you actually want to do something about their suffering. So it's just useful, like Paul Bloom does, to distinguish it from empathy, because empathy is just where you feel what the other person's feeling. So if they're depressed, you feel depressed. But compassion actually, like, intrinsically feels good. It feels good to desire that someone feels better. So in compassion meditation, you're trying to elicit this state of compassion. And the most common way you would do it, as far as I've seen, is you just repeat certain compassionate phrases like, may you be happy, may you be free from suffering, and so on.
I've also seen a version where you start by imagining someone you already love a lot. And then once you get that feeling of like love going, you then imagine, let's say, an acquaintance, and you try to like carry over that feeling to the acquaintance. And then you kind of go there from there to a total stranger, and then maybe eventually to someone you dislike, and so on. Would you say that's also a form of compassion meditation?
Yeah, I really think that you can do anything as long as it stimulates that feeling of compassion, then you can do whatever. And some people could stare into a mirror and get it. Other people could imagine, someone they love giving them compassion, or imagining like a fictional character giving them compassion. Some people imagine like an animal or like a non-conscious entity giving them compassion. So whatever triggers it, and it could be language-based as well. But yeah, it could just be pure imagery. And I think we might, if we have time, I think we'll discuss the differences between cognitive restructuring, like other self-help techniques, and compassion. And I think that's one difference, is compassion is potentially not language-based at all, whereas cognitive restructuring is.
Mm-hmm. Would you draw a distinction between compassion and love?
I haven't really thought about this too much. I feel like personally, I probably would just lean towards saying, yes, I can see a massive overlap there. And I think I have heard advanced meditators saying, yes, basically the same thing, but it's not a kind of romantic love or attachment love. It's just like, it's more kind of a more pure love.
Mm-hmm. Great. Okay. So you went on that retreat and you had these interesting experiences. So what happened next in your meditation journey?
Yeah, so again, I felt really, really good after that retreat, and I started to get more acquainted with this unconditional type of well-being, where I just kind of felt good for no reason, and I'd feel good doing really basic things like walking to the shops, and the logic of the practice started to dawn on me more. And I went through kind of an annoying evangelical phase at that point, where I was trying to convince my family and friends to do meditation.
Well, it's such an alluring idea that instead of having to go out and solve all these problems in order to be happy, right, that you could just sit and look at your hand, or, you know, walk to the store and have joy and have compassion for the people around you and have love, right? So you could definitely see why that could make someone evangelical if they get a taste of that.
Yeah, totally. And yeah, I'm not sure if this is jumping the gun, but like, I do feel like, broadly speaking, that is the most important goal of meditation and going on retreats, is to discover an alternative source of well-being that most people don't have, which is, yeah, it's not dependent on external circumstances in the way that we usually pursue well-being. Like you were saying, you know, achieving goals and getting rich and blah, blah, blah. It's something you can do without having any of those things. And it makes sense to cultivate both of those types of well-being as you live.
Right, like to do both simultaneously.
Yeah, yeah.
It reminds me of something, which is that I've noticed that if I'm eating food and I try to be really pay close attention to the food, to the sensation, be really, really present, it makes the food taste much better. And so you can imagine these two alternatives. One is like you go to a fancy restaurant to get really nice food. The other is you buy like decent normal food, but then you just pay close attention and be really present. And then it tastes as good as the super fancy expensive food. And it's like, it's kind of nuts that we don't just do that all the time, right? You can just get, you know, twice as much pleasure from each bite, when in practice, we're so distracted that often like we'll be taking bites and literally not even thinking about the fact that we're eating, not even aware of the pleasure, right? And I feel like with these ideas in meditation, it's taking that idea to the extreme. It's like, okay, but just looking at your hand could be as enjoyable as eating at an expensive restaurant, right? Something like that.
Yeah, totally. It's that insight that it's not just what we're paying attention to, you know, like pleasant physical sensations. It's how we're paying attention that can feel good in itself and can change the content of experience as well.
Yeah. And so what is the quest that you feel like you are on with respect to meditation? Is it to achieve these kinds of states you're talking about in a more lasting way or something else?
So, I mean, and this kind of continues from where I left off, is I kind of got into the more Theravada, they call it, tradition of Buddhism, which is especially a Burmese form of this, which is where you do mental noting, and they are adhering to a really specific model of enlightenment. And when I started to sit these retreats, I was like, oh, they're actually saying that enlightenment is a real thing and you can actually achieve it in this lifetime.
Right, and they have a path laid out, right?
They have a path, they have all the stages, they tell you how to do it. And as you get deeper into this thing, you can discover people who claim to have achieved one or multiple of these stages. And as I experience, you can become pretty obsessed with it.
Yeah. So tell us about what the different stages are. And as you understand them, obviously, you know, there's nuance that, you know, maybe you don't understand, maybe almost nobody understands, but I'd like to hear about what you understand about the different stages and then also about some of the techniques used on that path.
Yeah. So I can't remember the all of the different stages, but in one model, at least, there's 16 stages. And the claim is that everyone goes through the stages in the same order. And, you know, that there's different, the stages line up with different things that you notice, like you're noticing interdependence of different sensory experiences causing other sensory experiences.
So that's just to clarify that, that's the idea that we often feel like maybe a thought just pops into our head randomly or a feeling just occurs randomly. But if you pay really close attention to what's going on in your mind, you realize that most of the time, maybe all the time, I'm not sure, there's actually something that preceded that. Like, oh, I didn't just feel a random emotion. There was like a thought that occurred and that's why I felt the emotion. And then the thought wasn't totally random. There was actually, I looked at something in the corner of my eye that reminded me of something. That's why I had that thought and so on, that there's this kind of chain of causality. Is that what you're getting at?
Yeah, exactly. And it's the same kind of insight that we're trying to get people to have in the early stages of cognitive behavioral therapy. It's the same thing, but just in a different context, just to see there's a relationship between thoughts and feelings and behavior.
Right. Because in cognitive behavioral therapy, one of the key ideas is that your thoughts change how you feel, right? Like if I have the thought, I'm such a loser, mm-hmm. that's going to make me feel bad. How yeah. you feel changes how you behave. Like if I'm feeling really low, then I maybe will turn down, you know, my friend's request to go hang out because I'm like, I'm not in a good mood. I'm not going to enjoy it. And then your behaviors affect what thoughts you have because, you know, oh, you just sat at home playing video games all night and you might think, oh man, I've just wasted my whole night. Right. And then that feeds back into your feelings. So it's a kind of a circular, you know, feelings to thoughts, to behaviors, to feelings, to thoughts and so on. And that's essentially a macro version of this micro level insight in meditation where you're watching that happen kind of in real time in your mind. Would you say that's right?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So yeah, there's huge overlaps, at least at that point, between, you know, this ancient path of meditation and modern CBT, but different goals, I guess.
That's one of the things I find so fascinating about Buddhism is that it's almost like ancient psychology, essentially.
Yeah, ahead of their time. So, yeah, I don't know how much detail you want in the stages because I can't remember too much. I could look it up and go through some more of them.
Well, just tell us about, like, maybe you could tell us about some of the early stages.
Yeah, so that's one of the early stages. Another one is arising and passing away, where you just start to notice things moving much more quickly, and often it climaxes in some dramatic experience. And I'm sure meditators on this path would say the experience I had in my second retreat was an arising passing away. And people who walk away from a retreat saying this amazing thing happened, you know, other people claim that, yeah, that's an arising away experience.
Can you unpack that a little bit, the arising and passing away? What does that mean exactly?
Oh, it's The definitions I've seen of it are so broad that it's really hard to describe, and I can't remember too much of it, but when I've heard it, it was kind of described in, just being some peak experience that you wouldn't usually have, and it could be rushing physical sensations or some energy exploding through, your spine and up through your head. And
okay, so kind of a dramatic internal experience.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah, so that's how some people describe it. And then from memory after that comes, there's like a series of stages. They're called the dukkha nanas. And they're all about fear, like fear, misery, and disgust. So this is the dark night, essentially, where people, it's called like, people get tempted to roll up their meditation mat and get out of there because it starts to get, it can potentially be terrifying. And yeah, that's a stage that people need to can push through, but people can get stuck there.
What kind of experiences might someone have at that stage? Do you have more specific examples?
I think the most common one is some sort of dissolution of the feeling of being self that doesn't feel good. It's kind of terrifying, and I've had that. I've had experiences where I'm focusing on my breath and all of a sudden, it just feels like there's no one there paying attention to it. And it's not coincident with something pleasurable at all. It's terrifying. And people can feel like they're going to die or disappear. And that's when they freak out and go and talk to the teacher. And hopefully you have a good teacher who can guide you through it.
But they view that as sort of an essential part of the whole process because that's just a stage that everyone hits in this model, right?
Yeah. According to this path, like the Theravada, the Burmese Theravada path, yeah, it's just inevitable. You'll go through it. And I think it is quite, I think you do see it in a lot of traditions and many people do think it's inevitable. But I think I would hypothesize that the vast majority of people would have something a bit scary happen.
See, that's so interesting because when you hear about meditation in a kind of Western context, it's usually so light and fluffy and there's no talk about these like bizarre, upsetting experiences or fear or disgust or this unpleasant, disillusion from yourself. And what do you make of that?
It's interesting. And I mean, I kind of side on the Sam Harris perspective that things that are broadly good for us, like exercise, are going to have some downsides. Like you're going to get injured while you do it. So I'm not too concerned about it.
Because they're doing something and like the more something does, the more potential it has to cause good and harm, basically?
Yeah, things can go wrong. And yeah, I've had a meditation teacher who just puts it in, he frames it as, you're messing or you're tinkering with this like fundamental machinery of your mind, like foundational perceptions of the way things are, like self here, world out there. And things are bound to get shaken up and it's going to be scary when it, especially the first time it happens, it's going to be scary, but hopefully you get used to these experiences as you get more experience.
Well, that really gives, I feel like, an analog to something like psychedelics, right? Which you're also sort of shaking it up in a sense. And that might could also help explain why some of the experiences people have with psychedelics seem to mirror the experiences they have in meditation.
Yeah, totally. I think the only thing that is more scary on a meditation retreat is that you don't have that excuse of, oh, well, I've taken a psychedelic, so I'll come down off it soon. It's much easier on a retreat to think, oh, shit, I'm just permanently crazy now. I'm not going to get better.
You can see how that would create a spiral of terror, right?
Yeah, and I've been there. But a good teacher will remind you, the lovely, sublime experience you had before this, you've probably noticed that faded, and so this is likely to fade as well.
Yeah. Do people have dissociation experiences that you've seen?
Yeah, totally. I think that's a pretty common one in the dark night. And I think there's a strange overlap between I don't know the technical name, but dissociative disorder, I think it is in the DSM-5, and some of these meditative experiences.
Do you want to explain what dissociation is for those that have never heard of it?
I'm not sure how much of a good definition I'm going to give. Do you want me to look up one? I would just say it's just kind of a feeling of not feeling like yourself, like not feeling like a separate self in the conventional sense. And yeah, being unsure about like who and what you are. Yeah, I don't know the best definition of it off by heart.
So some of the experiences people have during dissociation are they might feel like the world isn't real or that they aren't real. Yeah. Sometimes they feel like they're out of their own body or like they're a different person. So it's some kind of sense of disconnection from themselves or from reality. Like you might feel like you're floating outside of yourself or like you're watching a movie. I've actually experienced it in the context of anxiety. Sometimes like a sudden spike of anxiety, like if a really stressful thing happening can give people a dissociation experience, which I've had happen. And that is fascinating because it almost feels like you took drugs or something. It's such a bizarre state you're in.
Yeah.
And fortunately for me, I kind of understand what it is because I've studied it. And so it actually makes it a lot easier if it happens. I'm just like, oh, okay, I'm dissociating. Cool. You know, in 10 minutes, I'll feel normal again. And just, I'll just enjoy it. Like it's kind of weird, trippy experience. But to someone who doesn't know what's happening, it can be absolutely terrifying because they're oh my gosh, the reality is not real anymore. Oh my gosh, I'm not me. You know, what's happening? So,
yeah.
If you're looking to test or improve your critical thinking, there's an engaging way to do so with clearerthinking.org. By integrating useful insights from psychology and economics into fun, interactive programs, clearerthinking.org helps you to make better decisions, create new habits, and achieve your goals. Whether you have just 5 minutes or an hour, you can use more than 30 interactive tools for free on their website. Try the rationality test, which tells you which of 16 reasoning styles best matches your thinking. Or the common misconceptions game to see if you are over or underconfident when you bet on what's fact or fiction. Clearer Thinking's work is based on scientific research about how to shift behavior in the real world. So check out their free tools and tests at clearerthinking.org.
Okay, cool. So let's keep going in your journey. So you have this huge path laid out in front of you. What were the techniques you were using when you were, you started on this journey?
Yeah. So my third retreat, I did my first 10-day retreat in the Goenka tradition, and I got pretty confused and annoyed when I got there because we were just doing this. Firstly, we're doing concentration on the breath, and yeah, fine, you do that for a few days.
That's Vipassana, right?
Yeah, that's Vipassana, but it's kind of a concentration type of. Actually, I don't think it's technically Vipassana. I think it's just like concentration. In the lead up to doing Vipassana or insight meditation.
I see. Okay.
So you do that for a few days and then you transition to Vipassana or insight meditation. And there I was waiting to, jump into being mindful of thoughts. But in the Goenka tradition, it's just a body scan. So you're just focusing on physical sensations, scanning through your body in this prescribed way. And if you have thoughts, you're just meant to ignore them and come back to your physical sensations. And I got huge benefits from that retreat. I felt like for about 3 months after, I felt pretty damn good, just like calm and like more regular experiences of blissfulness. And but then I still remember when they faded and I kind of returned to normality. That was frustrating, but I still thought that was a pretty good outcome for 10 days of meditation to feel good for that long.
Yeah. So how many hours were you meditating each of those days?
So that they do about 12 hours a day of formal practice. And then you're encouraged to try and maintain it in other activities like eating and so on.
So you're really trying to meditate every waking hour, but you're doing 12 a day, which is pretty intense. And so just to talk a little bit about the techniques a little bit more. So in the concentration meditation, you're just trying to focus on some little part of your breath, maybe the tip of your nose or something, and just stay completely focused on it, right?
Yeah, it's just like the triangle, beneath the nostrils and above your mouth. Like you just hone in on them and hold your attention there. And it can get easier and easier and better. And you start noticing the character of physical sensations, like they're changing and they kind of fizz in and out and so on.
Now, did anyone who's never tried to meditate before, that is just an incredibly hard thing to maintain your focus on. Like if you try to do it for even 2 minutes, you will find that you will immediately fail.
Yeah.
And which is fascinating. It's like, you might think you're in control of your mind, right? You might think, oh yeah, I'm telling my mind what to do. But as soon as you try to get your mind to do something like focus on the breath at the tip of your nose, it's just, immediately your mind will redirect you. Do you want to tell that story you told me about your meditation teacher saying to raise your hand when you have lost your focus?
Yeah, yes, this is great. I've sat a few retreats with this teacher, Patrick Kern. He's an Australian teacher and he's really, really good. And yeah, he just does an exercise where he gets the group to try and focus on, you know, some area of the body, maybe the hand. And as soon as you become lost in thought, you raise your hand. And so we start the exercise and, you know, I can't help. I know what he's trying to do here. but I still try and do the exercise, but I've got my eyes on him as well because I'm really interested to see how long he will last as a teacher. And so the bell goes. And then I see his hand basically go up after like a second. and then we go for about a minute. And yeah, maybe there's 25% of the group that never puts their hand up. And yeah, then we kind of debrief at the end of the experience and everyone's kind of unpacking what happened for them. And in my mind, you know, I'm just in total judgment mode. I'm like, how, to these people who didn't put their hands up, like, how could you think you could do this and the teacher can't?
It's because they were thinking about what they were going to eat for dinner. They had forgotten that they were supposed to meditate.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah, with zero meta awareness. And yeah, so it's just a great example of how people in the early stages can be pretty, pretty clueless about that kind of thing.
Well, you know, I think there's a few things going on there. One is that I'm much less experienced meditator than you are, but in my many experiments on myself with meditation, the more attention you pay, the more you realize you're distracted in some sense, right? It's like, if you're paying really terrible attention, you might not even realize you're distracted for a minute or 5 minutes, right? If you get really, really focused and honed in, you might almost immediately realize that your mind has just interrupted you or something. So that at least that's my read. Do you buy my interpretation of that?
Yeah. I also think it has something to do with the definition of distraction, because I've gone down this rabbit hole a bit on retreats. Like, if you define distraction as a single moment off the object you're trying to focus on, then I don't think it's possible to go more than like a microsecond, because I think our attention is so rapidly changing that it, even if it's just a quick microsecond, it's just going to glance off the object and then come back. But if you define distraction as being lost in thought for, you know, 5 seconds at a time, then I think you can start talking about claims of, okay, well, yeah, this time around, I managed to focus on the breath for 2 minutes straight until I got distracted.
Right. But it's sort of like the finer you hone your meditation ability, the more you can zoom in on those like little moments and even notice that something had happened, right?
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. Cool. So that was the concentration technique. And I mean, doing that for 12 hours a day, I mean, that's so hard to spend 12 hours trying to focus on just your breath. Okay. Then you, after doing that, for like 3 days or something, you move to the Vipassana technique where you're doing body scans. And so basically, the idea is that you pick a point in your body and then you notice what it feels like, and then you start moving your attention around the body slowly?
Yeah, this is probably one strength of the Goenka retreats, is it's all guided from the beginning. So it's all recordings of him. He's passed away now, but he'll guide you through the initial body scan, and you just start on the top of your head and pay attention to whatever's there. And he's always emphasizing equanimity. So you're not grasping at whatever's there, and you just notice whatever is there. So I guess there's a meta-awareness component. And then, you just kind of go down your arm, like one arm, then the other arm, and through the body, and then just come straight back up.
But very slowly, right? You're kind of very slowly moving throughout the body?
Yeah, it's quite slowly, but I think they've become more open to you going quicker. But by the end of it, he's saying you can kind of, it's like a sweeping technique. Like you're no longer going down in little sections or one arm at a time. You're just kind of sweeping through the whole body. And I never really got that. But many people, you know, say they do get it.
So funny thing about Goenka. So the way I got into meditation is doing experiments on myself. And I had some very weird experiences. I didn't know anything about meditation. This was back in college. One day I was just exploring like what my mind could do And I realized that I could make my arm go very convincingly pins and needles. Like, you know, if you accidentally like fell asleep on your arm and then it was like totally numb, that kind of awful pins and needles feeling. I realized I could actually generate that by just thinking about it. And I could get it to the point where it was like almost completely convincing, where I was like, okay, maybe my arm actually is asleep. And then I would move it and suddenly the pins and needles would be gone. So I'd know it wasn't like the real feeling. And once I realized I could do this, it was like, I was just all out in a crazy explore mode. And I was just trying all different ways of manipulating my experience with my mind. And then I did this for like 6 months of just trying all these weird experiments on myself. And then finally I was like, you know what? I'm sure other people have done this before. I wonder what they've done. And so, you know, the closest thing I could discover was like, okay, meditation is kind of like this. And so then I went to a library or bookstore, and I went to the meditation section, and I just looked through all the books. And for some reason, the Goenka book caught my eye, and I bought it. That was literally the first book I ever read on meditation. But I'd never heard of it. It was just complete coincidence.
Mm. Yeah. And so they spoke about that experience or similar stuff?
No, they didn't. They didn't. But they talked about what you were describing, like the body scan, stuff like that. But I was just trying to find other people who had explored these kind of weird things. And that's how I got interested in meditation. This was a long time ago, but for my memory of the body scan is that there's that element of, as you're scanning your body with your mind, you'll notice like, oh, in my shoulder, it feels kind of tight and unpleasant. And then you'll notice like, you know, my knee actually feels kind of nice. And it's like tingly in a pleasant way. And that you're supposed to not linger if the sensation feels good and not move away faster if sensation feels bad, but have that total equanimity of like sort of no craving, no aversion, regardless of the experience. Is that how you understood it as well?
Yeah, totally. Yeah. And they distinguish between like gross sensations that kind of seem solid, and then sensations that are changing. And from memory, I think they would say if you hit a gross sensation, like some sensation in your shoulder that's just not changing, then you can kind of linger there for a bit and see if it breaks apart. And if it doesn't, fine, move on. And I think that's the approach.
Great. Okay. So after that, you actually had a pretty big win for a few months. You felt really good. And then that started fading. So what was the next step in your journey?
Well, like any other drug addict, I sought another hit. So I went and sat I sat the same retreat I'd done the previous year. That was the first retreat I sat, the Tibetan Buddhism one. That was 5 days. And I was really reading a lot of Sam Harris's stuff then about, you know, the techniques of non-dual mindfulness, looking for the self. So I was really trying to do that on that retreat. And I just didn't really have any luck. I just didn't get it. And then after that retreat, I didn't really have the same benefits I usually had before. So I was a bit disappointed. I did have some, you know, things that weren't going very well in my personal life at that point, which no doubt had an influence.
Mm-hmm. Can you describe the technique that you're doing on that? And like, this might be a good time to talk about what non-dual means, because I know that you've investigated that further now. So like, what was the technique they were teaching? And then what do you mean when you're saying non-dual?
So this was, so I was not following the technique they were telling us to do on the retreat. I was doing what Sam Harris speaks a lot about. And this is before his meditation app. So he didn't really have too much guidance on this, but his instruction was to look for the self and just to keep doing that again and again. So there's the feeling of being a separate self, like the subject behind your eyes, staring out at a world external to your eyes that's separate to you. So you look for this sense of self. And the hypothesis is that there is nothing solid there. So if you look for it properly, you won't find it. And then you'll have this self-transcendent experience that they speak about in the non-dual traditions. So yeah, non-duality, if I have a bit of a crack at defining it, it kind of overlaps with selflessness in that it's arguing that at like consciousness at its most basic level of just awareness is not divided in any way. So it's not divided between subject and object or self and world. It's just one expanse of awareness, and that's everything. Everything else is impermanent and appearing in that space. So, yeah, is that an okay description of it?
No, that's great. That's fantastic. Yeah. So this might be a good time to talk about the distinction that you and I have been working on in our work. Could you walk us through this distinction that we've been working on between a technique, a skill, and an insight?
Yeah. So that these can be pretty finicky things to define, but we've had a crack. So what we're thinking for technique is it's something that you can realistically do right now that may or may not lead to the intended outcome. So it's really something that we have control over, something to do with our focus or thoughts or attitude. And then a skill is the ability to do something, like engage in a technique and reliably produce the intended outcome. So a good example in the context of meditation might be that the technique, say, of compassion meditation is to repeat compassionate phrases. That's something we can all control, but something those of us with less experience might not be able to cause is to elicit the state of compassion. So you might say the skill is being able to reliably produce a state of compassion through the technique of repeating those compassionate phrases.
Great, that's awesome. And so how does the insight fit in?
And then insights, the way we've defined that is they're kind of important things that you can learn about the human mind and about your own mind and or the nature of reality that people aren't usually aware of. So they're kind of, they're normative in terms of everyone in principle can achieve these insights, that they're just kind of truths about the way that the mind works, but they're things that we don't tend to notice. And, an example that might carry on from the example we're using for techniques and skills is you might have the insight from doing compassion meditation that it feels good to be compassionate. And it's a different kind of source of well-being than we're used to, trying to gratify our own needs. We can actually feel good just to desire that other people have their needs gratified.
That's really helpful. So the technique in this case is repeating phrases about compassion. It's something that you can do. You may or may not succeed at producing anything useful. But then we have the skill, which is actually feeling compassion. So the kind of thing you're aiming for. And then we have the insight in this case, which is that compassion feels good to do. So it's something you've learned from doing it. Would you say that insights are necessarily cognitive, or some of them more like a feeling or sort of something that you just intuit?
Well, that's a good question. I'm not really sure. I think the conventional Buddhists would argue that it's very intuitive because it's not a thought that comes up. A thought might follow, but I'm sure they would say it's like realizing something on a really fundamental level, just basic awareness of something happening in your mind. And not being aware of it through thoughts.
Right. So an example that I think about is the idea that everything is always changing internally, right? There's an insight that's linked to that. Do you have a name for that one?
Impermanence. Yeah.
Impermanence, right? So yeah. It feels like you could acknowledge in a very like intellectual, analytical system too kind of way, like, oh yeah, I realize that my brain is, is sending signals all the time and the signals are not totally consistent. There's noise in my brain, something like that. So of course, things are, first of all, things are changing across time, but even just the same signal is going to be varying. And so, yeah, I get that there's impermanence, but it feels like that somehow that's missing what people are really getting at when they talk about impermanence. Like they're talking about kind of witnessing it on a sort of deeper level. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I think that's a good example of understanding something conceptually, so through thoughts, like thinking the thought, oh yeah, so I'm aging, everything's getting older, people are dying, etc. But yeah, the argument in meditation is that it's a deeper non-conceptual perception of whatever the insight is, and then you just understand it on a deeper level. It just kind of permeates through your mind.
Yeah, maybe a nice example to illustrate this is the philosophical thought experiment, sometimes called Mary's Room, where you imagine a colorblind scientist who has never experienced color. Let's say Mary is totally colorblind, just sees the world in black and white, yet she's actually a color scientist. So in other words, she studies color scientifically and knows all these scientific facts about color. but she's never experienced it. And then imagine one day she gets a surgery that suddenly gives her the ability to experience color. In some sense, she now knows something about color on a very deep and visceral level that she didn't know before. And I'm kind of using this as an analogy here, where you can like know that things have impermanence, but that's not the same as experiencing it. The same way that Mary might know all kinds of things about color, but have never actually experienced it before.
Yeah, I think that's a really good example. And I imagine there's lots of people out there who meditate and they have a good conceptual grasp of all of the theory, but they haven't actually had many of the experiences themselves.
You know, this reminds me of something also that relates to psychedelics, which is sometimes when people do psychedelics, they'll come away with like some profound insight. And then if you ask them like, oh, what is your insight? They'll say something that sounds totally banal. It's like, oh man, it's all about love or something like this. And you're just like, oh, come on. But like, I think, you know, the cynical view is like, oh, they're just kind of confused or their mind playing tricks on them or something like this. But yeah, I think the kind of steel man view where we're trying to actually say like, okay, maybe there's really a there, like what could it be, is something like they had an experience that was visceral that's hard to turn into words, but changed maybe their priorities or changed their understanding of something important that they're now just trying to verbalize it and struggling to do that. Like Mary is trying to tell you what red looks like, right? Well, that's so hard to do.
Yeah, and it's probably something we can all relate to on some level.
Awesome. So let's go back to your journey. So where did we leave off?
So I sat that the same Tibetan Buddhist retreat and didn't get many benefits from that. And then a few months later, I sat another Goenka retreat and had, you know, some interesting experiences, but I had a similar kind of outcome where I didn't feel that much better after the retreat. And again, I had some personal issues going on at that point in my life, which I'm sure explained some of that.
Well, it's interesting because obviously, you know, our environment and the situations going on in life can affect it. But it also strikes me that meditation can feel very inconsistent. Like that's a common pattern where someone will go, they'll get this great feeling or this profound insight, but then the next time they don't get anything. I mean, do you have a sense that that's actually really common?
Yeah, I've heard, you know, numerous teachers talk about it. And I think Patrick has some things he says, like when you start a retreat, just forget everything about the previous retreat you did because you can't predict it at all. And he says that, you know, when you get students come in who say things like, oh, this is typical for day four on the retreat, you know, he doesn't believe that there's any predictable way to judge what's going to happen.
Well, that also relates to the thing that you sometimes hear meditation teachers say, which is like, don't have a goal, which I think can be frustrating because it's like, well, if I don't have a goal, why am I here? Why am I not doing something completely different? Why am I camping or, you know, horseback riding or any other thing in the world that I could be doing, right? But at the same time, I think it can be very bad coming in with too specific a goal, especially like when you're trying to meditate and being like, oh man, I thought I was going to be making progress and now I'm not. And like, you know, I'm sitting here and nothing's happening. And so do you have any thoughts on this idea of like having a goal and the advantages and disadvantages?
Yeah, I think there's pros and cons. And I think you can kind of distinguish between a long-term goal that you've kind of just got in the back of your mind, as opposed to a short-term goal in terms of what you want to be doing with your attention right now. Because I don't think anyone, you know, especially in the Theravada tradition, I think everyone's got the goal of achieving enlightenment, but obviously it's not going to help to have that goal in the present moment. And however that would look, I don't know, I guess that you'd just be lost in thought about enlightenment and not doing the practice properly.
It reminds me of like spending time with loved ones. If you're like, we've got to be bonding right now, we've got to be having a great time. And you know, it's like, no, just chill out and like just spend time with your family. But you also like in the back of your mind have a goal, like you want to feel connected to your family, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Cool. Okay. So you didn't have a great experience that time, or you didn't have any really profound things occur. So what happened next?
So at that point, I actually lost a bit of interest in meditation and wasn't really planning on doing more retreats. I was just focusing on my PhD and other things.
Were you just thinking like, oh, it's not worth the investment, or maybe it's bogus? What were you thinking at that point?
Yeah, I think I lost a bit of belief that it was, you know, the most important thing in life. I still had plans to do more, and I still knew that it could have big benefits, but I think a bit of that hope had been kind of reduced. And then what happened was a friend of mine let me know that this teacher I've been referring to, Patrick Kearney, was running a retreat in Adelaide. And I, yeah, decided to have a crack at it because I had heard good things about him. And yeah, that was a short retreat and it was quite life-changing. It was the first time I'd had a meditation teacher who kind of blew me away. Like I'm always, you know, I'm the dude sitting at the back who's skeptical about all the claims, but this teacher, he was a very good storyteller, and he's one of those storytellers that kind of builds up to this epic climax. And I remember some evenings when he'd been doing talks, he'd get to the climax and I'd be like sitting at the back of the room with like my jaw dropped. and yeah, there were just a few insights I had on that retreat. And that was also the first retreat when I was doing proper mental noting, because he taught that style of meditation and I really liked it.
Because before you'd kind of done your own version that is based on like ACT therapy.
I did it myself. Yeah. And it was just thoughts that I was labeling. And now this was kind of global labeling of every experience, including physical sensations and thoughts and sounds.
So were you doing that the whole time, the labeling technique?
Yeah, the whole time on that retreat, because I really liked it. And you know, you learn that you can take anything as an object. And I was really bored in the first few days of the retreat. And so I just shared that with him and he's like, take that as the object. And then, yeah, boredom can become quite interesting.
So you're just whatever you're aware of, you're assigning a label to it. You're saying, I'm bored right now. Can you give me an example? Like, what's the internal loop look like when you're doing this technique?
Yeah, so, I mean, you can kind of choose the level of label that you want to use. So if you're not feeling too, you know, detail-oriented, you can have boredom arise and then you can just repeat boredom, like boredom, boredom. Or if you want to get into more detail, there might be some other associated experiences like dullness, you can label that, or, you know, heaviness in the head, heaviness, flat.
And what other things are you noticing? Your things in your environment too?
Yeah, whatever is your primary object of attention, you note that. So yeah, your attention might jump from the boredom to something else.
Okay, so you're still focused on something, or are you letting your attention wander to whatever it will?
I think like this teacher would allow you to either do, you know, use an object like your breath as an anchor, or do open awareness. And I've always just gravitated towards open awareness. So I was just taking whatever was primary in my attention as the object.
So you might jump from like, oh, there's a bird outside, to like, oh, I'm bored, to, oh, my leg hurts. And you're just, each time you're just noting, you're like, yeah, bird, boredom, leg pain, whatever it is. You're basically creating a meta-awareness of your, whatever you're aware of. Is that right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Got it. And then how many days was that and how many hours a day were you doing?
I think that was only, seven days. And he was extremely flexible with how much we practiced, but probably doing 8 hours a day of formal practice, or maybe more at times. And he would let us sleep if we needed to sleep. That was wonderful.
Mm-hmm. And then I assume there'd be breaks, like those would be done in chunks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. So what were some of the experiences you had during that? And then how did you feel after?
The experiences weren't too meditative. It was more, I nearly used a spooky word, but I may as well use it. I was going to say transmission. I don't know how people will feel about that word, but it felt like when he'd give his talks, sometimes something would just click in my head. And the big thing that clicked for me on that retreat was, you know, I'd heard about this Buddhist insight of dukkha or unsatisfactoriness, and I just thought it was a vague claim about, you know, the way it's just hard to, you know, have lasting fulfillment. But in Buddhist tradition, at least, it's actually like a moment by moment claim about conscious experience. That they're arguing that basically every conscious experience is unsatisfactory by its very nature, and to remediate that you need to meditate a lot. And that kind of blew my mind when I understood that.
let me just ask a question about the unsatisfactoriness, because that's really interesting, because I've heard that phrase before, but I thought it was more like, oh, well, you know, you're going to have craving and you're not going to get the things you want all the time and you're going to have suffering and you're going to be averse to it and you're not going to be able to get away from it right away all the time. Mm-hmm. But you're saying that, like, if you zoom in super far into just moment-to-moment experience, there's a claim that the moment-to-moment experience has an element of a sort of fundamentally unsatisfactory nature if you really pay close attention, if you hone your mind that level. Can you say anything about that?
Yeah, I think the extreme version of the claim, I think Daniel Ingram says this, that every single experience is unsatisfactory if you pay close enough attention. So even like the most blissful state.
And what does that mean, unsatisfactory here? It means that, yeah, could you elaborate? I know it's hard to talk about, but...
I think there's something that feels bad about it, something that doesn't feel very good. Or it's just imperfect.
So it's imperfect, but like it might feel more good than bad, right? It's not saying that it always feels more bad than good. It's just saying that there is some part of it that feels off or bad.
Yeah, I think that's true. Yeah.
You could imagine that being a very disturbing experience, because it's sort of like saying everything is never going to be perfect. Everything always has something wrong with it. Why is that a good thing to be aware of?
I think they would argue it's a good thing because it will motivate you to get enlightened and meditate a lot.
Ah, so it's just a step on the way. It's like a, hey, look how much, look how shitty every single moment it is.
Yeah,
and don't you want to fix that?
Yeah, but for me, it was the most therapeutic part of that insight was, I think my envy reduced a huge amount of other people and famous people and successful people, because I just realized more that they just have the same qualms as me, that they're just like, you know, that their mind is, we're not exactly the same, but they're going to be struggling with many conventional things despite their successes in life.
Right. They're still going to feel anxiety and pain and envy and anger. And
yeah.
And
like even just ignoring the more extreme versions of suffering, just like the walking down the street to the shops, like there's many people who are just, you know, going to find that mundane and uninteresting. And,
yeah.
You know, a lot of people are victim to that.
So then would you say that what you felt changed you after that retreat was more like this insight, or is it more like you were describing with past retreats where you just felt like better, you felt good for a long time?
It was both. I had the same kind of blissful kind of, you know, I felt equanimous and calm in a pretty stable way. I think, again, it was a few months of feeling pretty damn good. And then I also had this insight which reduced my envy. And maybe most importantly, it completely changed the trajectory of my life, like what I wanted to do when I finished my PhD. Like it made me single-minded that I wanted to spend as much time on retreat as I could, you know, before I get sucked into work.
Because now you're back on the path and you said, okay, now I see there's something really here. Like you maybe lost your way.
I was back on the path in a big way, yeah.
Are world events affecting your mental health? Try Uplift. The Boston Globe said this app could be the future of mental health, and it's used by thousands of people. In a study on Uplift, users felt an average of 52% better in just 1 month. It comes with 12 interactive and information-packed sessions that help you master well-being skills that are typically taught in therapy. You do the sessions independently, but the Uplift narrator feels like you've got a compassionate mentor guiding you towards long-lasting success the entire way. You'll also have a toolbox of mood-boosting techniques in your pocket at all times that you can use to feel immediate relief when you need it. The first session and several tools are free, and you can try the full program with a 7-day trial. Discover Uplift and feel happier, calmer, and mentally stronger. To find out more and to get started, visit uplift.app. That's uplift.app.
So what happened next?
So then my PhD got really intense. I was kind of pumping the final year of that. I managed to do one retreat, and that was very short, but quite pleasant, but nothing crazy. It just kind of continued my, maintained my motivation. And as this final year of my PhD was progressing, I was eyeing off a 1 month retreat with the teacher I spoke about, Patrick Kearney, and making plans for that. And so, yeah, basically I finished my PhD and worked for a little while. And then I went over to Sydney and to the Blue Mountains in Australia on the East Coast. And I, sat my first long retreat.
So entire month. And was this a noting based, or did you use different techniques?
Yeah. So this is, again, was with Patrick, and you know, it's largely, you know, the kind of Burmese Theravada mental noting that he's encouraging, but he's very flexible with you doing whatever. And yeah, it was pretty kind of intimidating and scary to do it, but yeah, it was probably the most important thing I've ever done in my, my life.
So you're basically meditating pretty much all day for a month.
Yeah. Yeah. You can kind of choose how much you want to do it formally, but yeah, it's pretty strict with, you know, no talking. You might need to communicate a bit when you're doing jobs, but yeah.
But no talking to the other participants, no reading, no going on a computer or a phone, right?
No, your phone's off, computer's off. You're encouraged to not read anything, but just keep notes of your meditation experience. But try to avoid, you know, note taking on other stuff that's just going to be a distraction.
Wow. And so tell us about that experience.
So it was just really interesting, because it's a way of running the experiment properly, of trying to determine if there's a type of well-being that's just not conditional on the conventional sources of well-being, because everything's removed and you're just meditating all day, every day.
Because there's nothing external to be happy about, right? You're just sitting there in a room.
It's comfortable. It's comfortable.
Sure. But there's nothing exciting by the normal standard that's happening.
No. But you just notice that you're feeling better and better. At least this is my experience, and I think this is quite a common experience. You start to feel better and better, and it just doesn't seem to make any sense. And I just remember sitting under this tree on like day 21 or something. I was like, I was lost in thought. I think this is the happiest moment of my life. I remember completely at peace. And then there were other important insights I had. I noticed whenever I started to feel really good, I'd get lost in thought about, you know, wanting to plan and try and get evangelized and get family and friends involved and so on. And then I started to feel bad, and you know, it took seeing this relationship again and again of feeling good, getting lost in thought, feeling worse, to realize that most of the time being lost in thought is not going to be an experience that makes you feel good. So that gave me extra motivation to try and reduce the amount of time I'm lost in thought.
It reminds me of an interesting study I saw where they ping people randomly at different times of day, and they just basically asked, how good or bad do you feel right now? And then they said, what are you doing? And one of the things that, if I recall correctly, they found correlated with feeling bad was just being lost in thought.
Yeah.
Now, I assume that there's different kinds of thoughts, some positive, some negative. Like, for example, probably a lot of being lost in thought is like thinking about something we have to do, we don't want to forget, or worrying about something in the future, or like having an unpleasant memory. But on the other hand, some of being lost in thought might be like reminiscing about some really fun thing that happened to us in the past. And I assume that's not going to be unpleasant. So maybe it might be true that on average, like the bulk of being lost in thought is negative, but I imagine some of the being lost in thought is actually pleasant. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. Yeah. I think, you know, in a conventional way, being lost in thought about some lovely memories is going to feel good. But when I've paid attention to my experience, I would estimate that like probably 90% or more of my thoughts are either negative or neutral, and you know, a small minority are positive. I don't expect that I'm different from average. I think this is just the way mine is. But I think you've said that you tend to be more positive on average, right?
I don't think so. No, I would say that probably the bulk of my mental content is negative also, if I pay close attention, like you described. And actually, funnily enough, I ran a little survey. It was just a Twitter survey, so not super scientific, but I was curious to ask people about like what their typical moment-to-moment experience is. So here's the question I asked people. 175 people gave their answer, so a decent sample size. I said, if at a random waking moment on a random day, you're asked to reflect on how you are feeling at that moment, which of the following four states are you most likely to be in? So basically the idea is like, what's your most common waking state? And the options were good or happy is the first one, tired or sleepy is the second one, anxious or stressed, the third one, and then bad but not tired or anxious was the last one. And the most common was good or happy. That was about 43% of people said that that's their most common mental state that they have. Now, they could be wrong about that. Like, most people are not paying that close attention, and obviously most people are not trained meditators. But then 27% said tired or sleepy. So you think about that. You ping a random person a random moment, and 27% of people saying that their most likely thing is that they're tired or sleepy. And then about 23% said anxious or stressed. And then finally, about 6% said bad, but not tired or anxious, or some other bad state. So that, to me, that was really interesting. And insofar as people are actually accurately reporting, it's like 43% of the time good or happy. And then the rest of the time is not a very great state, right? So that would actually suggest the majority is not a great state for the majority of people.
Yeah, okay. So that maps onto what we're saying.
Yeah, although this is across people, and we're talking about within a person, right? We're talking about within yourself. And this is looking across, you know, lots of people and saying what's the most common state. But anyway, I thought that was interesting. Okay, so you're experiencing some of these blissful states. Did you have other interesting experiences on that retreat?
Yeah, so I the first kind of dramatic experience I had on that retreat was I was meditating one night, and I had my eyes closed, and one thing that can happen as you progress in a retreat is that your visual thoughts can become more and more lucid, and your dreams can become super lucid as well. It happens every time for me. And I was just noting thoughts, and then they started to become really quick and rapid. And I was kind of paying attention to this visual of like a roller coaster almost. And then I had this sudden feeling of getting pulled from the vantage point of behind my eyes into the world and like sucked into this like roller coaster.
And you were sitting and meditating at this time, right?
Yeah, eyes closed. Yeah. And meditating. And it was almost like getting sucked into a TV. Like it was that kind of destabilizing kind of experience. And it wasn't pleasant at all. And I kind of sat back, and it kind of made me a bit shocked at how powerful this tool is, that you can have these psychedelic experiences when you're sober. And then I obviously went and spoke to my teacher about it. And
you're essentially hallucinating at that moment, right?
Yeah. Even if it's eyes closed, it's still, you know, big, because it's like proprioceptive hallucinations in a way.
Yeah, just to comment on that for a moment, some people actually don't have any mental imagery, which is kind of surprising to a lot of people, but there is a small percentage of people that can't even imagine things in their mind, yet they still seem to function, you know, just fine. You would never know for the most part, but a lot of people, most people do feel like they can visualize things in their mind. What I think fewer people are aware of is that most people can actually simulate any experience in their mind. Like, so it's not just visual. You can actually simulate. So when I was making my arm get this pins and needles feeling, that's not an image. That's a feeling, right? You could also simulate feelings of heat. Like in meditating, I can imagine the feeling of heat on my skin and like actually start to feel it as though it's there. And you can get almost any kind of experience. And so the idea that you had this proprioceptive hallucination is not really that weird when you think of it that way. It's like, well, we imagine things in our mind all the time. We're just not used to being like on this other dimension of sensation, but it can totally happen. So it was a very highly vivid, which also makes it unusual. Yeah. And also it sounds like it felt out of control. Like it didn't feel like you were doing it. Yeah. It was like it was happening.
Yeah.
Which also, so all those elements make it, again, a very bizarre seeming experience.
Yeah.
Oh, can I just ask, what did your teacher say about that?
Yeah, he just, as always, he just wasn't shocked by it, which is actually strangely reassuring. And he said it's quite common as the mind, you know, the language they use is growing more powerful as you were on retreat, you know, with concentration and so on. You can have these experiences of getting sucked into what seems to be external. And I was telling him I was scared, and it's basically like, you know, you don't need to be scared. What are you scared of? So that really gave me encouragement to dive back in and embrace fear. So I kept going, and I was like, I did have the distant goal in mind of stream entry. Maybe should I define that?
Yeah, please tell us about what is stream entry?
Stream entry, it's a stage in the Theravada model of Buddhist enlightenment, whereby, like, you know, I was talking about those 16 stages before, but we can call those sub-stages. So those sub-stages are building up to a climatic experience called cessation, where everything disappears, all the contents of consciousness. There's a lot of stigma around talking about this, and I should say I have not experienced it. So it's hard to get a lot of details about what it's like, but from what I hear, all the contents of consciousness disappear, sight, sounds, and so on. And what's left behind is this really basic awareness. So there's some awareness of what's happening, and then everything comes back online, but there's just a clear change of, like, something profound has happened, and the meditator knows this.
And you're different afterwards, right? It's like permanently
changed. And you're different. You're permanently changed. So this model argues there's permanent psychological changes that are specific, and they occur at each of the four stages of enlightenment.
Just to clarify something. So the four stages that you're talking about, do they come at the end of the 16, or are they a way of grouping the 16?
So, like, in terms of the major stage of stream entry will come at the end of these 16 sub-stages, but you need to cycle through them each time you get to a major stage. So you cycle through all 16 and you get stream entry, great. And then you cycle, and then you go back on retreat, cycle through all of them again, and then you reach second path or second stage, then you keep repeating this process. That's my understanding.
Got it. So you do the 16 basically four times, one for each of the big stages. Got it. The 16 steps. Yeah. Okay. Makes sense. Cool. And so stream entry is the first of the big stages. And so what is stream entry?
Yeah. So in stream entry, they're saying that is when you enter the stream of enlightenment, and they're arguing that there's certain psychological changes that are permanent. And in the case of stream entry, they're saying that those psychological changes are you lose the belief that there's a separate and unchanging sense of self. The second one is you lose the belief that rites and rituals are necessary to purify yourself. And the third one is you lose any doubt that, you know, this is the spiritual path that is the right path for you to follow. Mm-hmm. So doubt is kind of uprooted that they mm-hmm.
fall. And you did not feel like you experienced stream entry, right?
No, but, like, I think it's a very easy thing to misdiagnose, and there's huge variations in how prevalent stream entry seems to be in different populations. So, you know, if you survey some of the biggest meditation teachers, and there's an academic article I've seen reporting on this, and I've asked one teacher myself, it seems like the success rate is like 2-3% of people sitting like 3-month retreats, which is crazy low.
Wow. So people meditate for 3 months, and only 2-3% may reach the first big stage of stream entry of the four big stages. Right.
Yeah.
So that's pretty intense. So one thing that when I hear about something like stream entry, like it had the way you described it, had these really three very specific realizations. I guess I just find that implausible, because I think of the human mind as something that evolved through, you know, millions of years of evolution. It just seems so strange to me that there would be such a predictable pattern where after everyone goes to these 16 stages, they can theoretically, at least if they work hard enough, reach this incredibly specific three realizations, right? It's so incompatible with my view of, like, what the human mind is. I'm curious if you have any thoughts on that.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I'm in complete agreement where it doesn't make any kind of intuitive or logical sense that something like this would occur in four parts. It doesn't seem to make any sense to me. Like, it seems to maybe make sense in one part, like one realization, but not in four. It doesn't make any sense to me.
Well, you know, and I would say that, like, I could certainly buy the argument that human minds tend to have the nature that for whatever reason, they can be kind of hacked in this way where they if you do certain activities, you tend to have certain results, and some of these results might be somewhat predictable. It just was is very bizarre to me, the possibility that it could be so specific, right? In like 16 sub-stages followed by one big stage, and you repeat them, and so on. So I'm not kind of denying that it's possible that you could have some of these regularities and some of these patterns. I just think they just seem way too hyper-specific to me.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think there's kernels of truth to it, but I just think there's no way that people go through each of those same stages. And when you ask people who are, you know, who really believe in this path, there seems to be a lot of cognitive biases that come up. Like if they think you're in a particular stage, but then you say, well, I don't remember experiencing any of this, you know, they'll argue maybe you just didn't notice it. It's a bit dogmatic.
Right. So it becomes a little bit unfalsifiable at that point. Yeah. Well,
yeah.
This might be a good moment to just sit back and talk about the connection between meditation and religion, because many people view meditation as part of religion. Other people take a totally secular view. And then there's, I would say, almost like a third camp that would say something like Buddhism is not secular, but it's also not religion in the classic sense. How much is religion connected to the way meditation is taught? Like when you're learning about it in these different places, is it sort of fundamentally connected to religion, or is it kind of extracted out of religion?
It's definitely connected on one level. Like the vast majority of places where you do meditation in the world, especially if you're going over to Southeast Asia to learn, it's going to be in a religious context. But there's different traditions that they have more of an ability to practice if you're secular, like me. Without, you know, they're not going to try and impose any of their beliefs on you. You'll still need to sit there and listen to talks in the evening where they're going to make religious claims about reality. But when you're actually practicing meditation, there doesn't need to be anything religious happening.
In one of the meditation books I read, there was this FAQ at the end of the book, you know, like frequently asked questions. And I was really fascinated. I was like, what are the frequently asked questions, right? And one of the questions was, is it true that meditation can give you psychic powers? And the response of the meditation technique teacher was, yes, it's true. Meditation can give you psychic powers, but you should ignore them. They're not the point of meditation and they're a big distraction. So just don't worry about it. And I thought that was so fascinating because, you know, most people would be like, psychic powers, oh my gosh, that's amazing. You know, you should explore that. Yeah. And this was like, no, it's going to distract you. And another question in the FAQ was, I believe, is it true that through reincarnation, you can get reincarnated as a god? Because, you know, I mean, as you know, meditation has connection to kind of viewpoints about reincarnation. And so they were asking, you know, can you get reincarnated as a god? Because, you know, if you look at, you know, ancient Buddhist texts, gods play a role in that world, like they're characters in the world. And the meditation teacher said in response to that, yes, you can get reincarnated as a god, but I really don't recommend it because it's actually easier to achieve enlightenment if you get reincarnated as a human. And I was like, it was so fascinating to me because just such a different way of looking at the world. And it's like, well, they're trying to teach meditation on the one hand, but on the other hand, it's imbued with this system of, you know, this kind of spiritual system. So what kind of experiences do you have with that when what is the sort of spirituality or religion that you're seeing connected to the techniques when they're being taught to you?
I've definitely heard claims before. This is more in, I think Theravada seems to be a bit more empirical, and there's a bit less religiosity in the Theravada tradition, which is really nice for people like us. But definitely when I've spoken to someone in the Tibetan tradition, it sounded like there was more religiosity there. And the person I was speaking to was making all sorts of claims about, you know, teachers being able to read your mind and you don't need to even do reports to them because they already know what's going through your mind. And that's a bit concerning. Yeah, but in terms of, so you, do you mean, you know, how does spirituality affect the actual practice itself, or just in terms of your experience on a retreat, like listen to talks and so on?
I guess what I'm wondering is, when they're teaching you these techniques, do they reference spiritual things? Do you feel like it's fundamentally intertwined with spirituality, or can it really be fully extracted?
I think it can be fully extracted. I think there's and people have done that, like the secular American traditions or in wherever in the West, you can definitely find places where they teach these techniques like mental noting, and there's no religious beliefs attached to it.
It feels to me like there's these two sides that can both be potentially problematic. On the one side, mm-hmm. you can have a meditation tradition that's rooted in a set of religious or spiritual beliefs that you don't believe in, right? And then mm-hmm. it's like, it's hard to engage with if you don't believe in the kind of spiritual side of it. On the flip mm-hmm. side, it feels like the westernization of meditation can also be a problem, where it gets so watered down, it ends up mm-hmm. feeling like yoga for fitness, rather, you know, the way that yoga traditionally like might have had deeper meanings than just, you know, I want to be able, you know, get fit and stretch, right? It's like meditation can get to this point where it almost just feels like a simple self-help technique and there's nothing beyond that.
Yeah, that I think both of those extremes are really annoying. And yeah, that's the common criticism you hear of the westernized meditation. And there's a nice phrase that Daniel Ingram uses. I think his teacher, Bill Hamilton, came up with this of the mushroom culture, where you just keep them in the dark and feed them shit. It's like that was their perspective on how a lot of the Western meditation teachers were treating their students, because the teachers knew that there were these models of enlightenment, but they were barely teaching them at all. That was the criticism. And yeah, that seems to be a shame, because it can be really motivating, even if you don't believe in, you know, enlightenment as they define it. You might believe one step shorter, or you can just have profound transformations in your well-being from intensive meditation.
Something else we didn't talk about that I think is really interesting is, in our project we're working together to map out meditation, we're also mapping out the full diversity of skills. And one of the things that's really struck me in that work is that, first of all, there's just a huge number of meditation techniques, way more than most people realize. There's also a huge number of skills that you can work on developing. It's like going to the gym and thinking that the only thing at the gym is barbells and just using barbells your whole life and not realizing that the gym has all these things to offer. Like, meditation, in a sense, is such a broad collection of things that you're potentially training. So do you want to just talk about the definition of meditation that we've used, sort of in its full generality?
So yeah, what we, and some background is, oh my God, like the definitions of meditation are just a mess when you look them up. They're all over the place, and it's a very difficult thing to define. But what you and I came up with was that meditation is a type of mental training that involves focused and repetitious cognitive engagement in a method. So it can involve some behavioral components too, but it's primarily cognitive. And it's done in order to cultivate certain mental skills. And these mental skills can help the practitioner to achieve certain desirable mental outcomes. So that could be cultivating a state of compassion or having an insight like selflessness. And then just some extensions on that definition we put in were like, being focused is really central to meditation. It's really core, because it involves a non-default mode of cognition. So not being lost in thought that's irrelevant to the task you're doing, or not just doing something that naturally draws attention like television. It's got to be something more focused. And yeah, it's got to be something you can repeat as well.
Right. And that kind of suggests why there are so many types of meditation and so many different skills you could develop, because there's so many objects of focus and there's so many little mental maneuvers, right? Like, one thing you'd be trying to do is like get your focus down to the pinpoint, you know, of where your breath leaves your nose when you breathe, and which is very hard to focus on. And another thing you could be doing is trying to focus on your entire range of sensory experience, everything that your body is taking in as a sense right now, which is kind of almost the opposite. And then you could be doing something like trying to produce a feeling like compassion. So there's just so many different approaches to, you know, what you focus on and kind of with what intention.
Yeah, totally. And that's why it was really helpful what we did to come up with different categories of these different skills, because you can be, there can be skills around attention, around changing your identity, changing perspective, changing the way you're feeling, improving, you know, different faculties like memory. Yeah, there's just a huge range. And then the more profound ones, you know, recognizing the nature of the mind. So there's a lot that you can be doing.
If If you're feeling stressed or anxious and need to calm down quickly, you should try MindEase. MindEase is a free app for iOS, Android, and the web that uses scientifically proven exercises to help you relieve stress and anxiety in under 10 minutes. MindEase works with your specific situation and thought patterns. The exercises are interactive and engage you actively. You'll be writing, reflecting, making choices, reading, listening, and performing actions that are all designed to move you to a calmer state of mind. Since no two people experience anxiety the same way, why should we expect any single way of calming down to suit everybody? MindEase offers a range of evidence-based techniques for managing stress and anxiety. And sometimes it's tricky to tell how much better something has made you feel, so MindEase makes that simpler by measuring your state of mind before and after each exercise so that you can see exactly how well it worked. The app's insights page makes it easy to see what works for you and what doesn't. When you're feeling curious and eager to learn, the app's Explore page has a wealth of tools aimed at helping you grow and understand yourself better. To find more info and to get the free MindEase app, go to mindease.io. That's MindEase.io.
So we've been on the phone for a while now. Let's finish up. I'd love to hear the end of your journey. You want to tell us about that?
Well, yeah, there's still quite a bit to go. It's a hard thing to summarize, but like maybe one thing that could be most interesting for listeners was, yeah, I was getting towards the end of this month-long retreat. And when people often say that when you get towards the end, you know, it's basically, you've basically lost it. You know, you start getting lost in thought about planning and That's what was happening to me. I got completely lost in thought in all the stuff I needed to do afterwards and returning to normal life and what it was going to be like. And it was about day 26 and I just had this insane energy that I just couldn't control. So I was kind of pacing back and forth. I thought the retreat was basically done for me. I managed to calm down a bit. I went inside to the meditation hall and I started meditating. And yeah, I was paying attention to the sense of self and then to the breath. And then I had an experience that I'd had before where all of a sudden I could perceive the breath, but there didn't seem like there was any self there doing the perceiving. So then I got hit with terror. And then the second half of the experience was all of a sudden, like this perceived gap or boundary between me and the world just collapsed. Like I think it collapsed all the way. It might've been most of the way, who knows, but it collapsed in this huge way that I've never experienced before. And that lasted for about 2 seconds.
Oh, wow, that's right.
And then, yeah, and then there was, you know, anxiety and I noted that. And then it was such a peak experience that I went straight to my room to write it all down. And something just felt different. And like, I felt good. I felt like really calm. I had the experience, I finally understood what a lot of people were talking about when they're talking about looking for the sense of self and just finding activity. So for the first time in my life, I had some idea of what Sam Harris was talking about. I looked for this solid sense of self and there was just activity, this constellation of physical sensations changing and so on. And that was a little bit scary, but it was also quite interesting.
It sounds like also the boundary broke down with the sense that you're different from everything else in the world. Like, was it like a feeling of merging, or there's just no boundary between you and everything else?
Yeah. So there were some really hard things to put into words, but there was something like that where the world didn't seem as other, like as external or separate to me than usual. And there was almost like an affective tone to the world where it just seemed more open and friendly than before, like less threatening. And yeah, I mean, the climax of this experience was I went for a walk out on the street and it was just the most sublime experience of my life. Like I just felt like this huge burden had been lifted. There's no more problem, you know, down to my core. And I felt blissful and happy, like I'd achieved something huge. And I was just kind of crying and laughing. And wow. It was incredible. And then I came back to the retreat center and I felt a little bit of dread, but that kind of faded. And then the rest of the night was wonderful. Even my dreams were quite wonderful. This insight seemed to kind of permeate my dreams and just everything felt different. And then I woke up in the morning and it was still there, this feeling of, you know, the self just being activity. But then it kind of started to creep into, like, I was feeling equanimous, but that kind of started to feel like it was indifference. And then it started to get a bit scary. And then I started to catastrophize.
Wait. So let me make sure I understand. So during the meditation experience, you had this 2 seconds of feeling like no separation between you and the world.
Yeah.
But what continued after that was the sense of like the self being just activity or not being there or something like that. Is that right?
Yeah. Most of the time I looked, the self just felt like activity, and like I couldn't find anything solid there.
Well. So then, and then as the time goes on, you're like just kind of observing this neutrally. And then, but as time goes on, it starts becoming a little bit frightening, right?
Yeah. And like, it's frightening because I'm jumping to conclusions about what the rest of my life is going to be like. I'm just going to be this zombie walking around indifferent to everything, you know, not suffering on any major way, but just indifferent and not engaging.
So at first you felt like quite blissful, or maybe very blissful, but then was it feeling like you weren't having joy anymore? Or what was that experience like internally as the days ticked by?
Yeah, totally. It was depression and anxiety. It was like really intense anxiety as it got worse and worse. And yeah, at that point, I went and sought help, and I went and spoke to a teacher. And yeah, I actually cried in front of him. Like I was actually feeling better by that point, but it was just to be able to, I don't know if like you've had this experience, just like finally being able to get the support you need, you feel so good in a way. And I just released all these emotions, and he was just amazing. He just reassured me completely, just explained what it's like to be, that the sense of self will return, and he did. And he just told me to basically stop meditating, and the retreat was kind of done for me, and I could just go and relax and walk around and so on. So yeah, that was how it ended. And that anxiety kind of faded. And then I kind of like, I want to be careful with this claim because you know, you never know. And I think not too much time has passed, it's almost been 2 years, but I do think that I've had, some significant psychological changes since that event.
That you attribute to that event happening, that 2 second experience, essentially.
Yeah.
Yeah. And how would you describe the ways that you've changed? I mean, I assume that sense of indifference started to fade.
Yeah. The bad stuff faded, and then it mostly, got replaced by good stuff.
But let me ask you about that, because indifference sort of sounds like what meditation teachers are sometimes talking about as a desirable state. Mm-hmm. Like they talk about, you're not going to have craving and aversion anymore. That's the way to free yourself from suffering. Some of them say things like that. But isn't that very similar to indifference? What's the difference between that and indifference?
Yeah, like to be honest, I think there are some teachers who use equanimity and indifference in the same way. But I feel like most of them will distinguish between the two. And I don't know if I'm going to be able to define it, but like it feels intuitively like there's a difference there. Like indifference is like you just don't care. There's like an apathy and maybe an insensitivity.
I see. Almost like depression or something. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Whereas equanimity, you can still kind of engage with things, but you're just not getting thrown around.
So equanimity is like you're witnessing what's there and you may be taking pleasure in it, but you don't need it to be any different than it is. Would you say that that's true?
Yeah. Yeah.
I see.
I think that's a good way to put it. But I think honestly, I would need to have a bit more of a think about the differences between them. But I just know that subjectively they feel different to me.
Right. So what are some of the changes you feel like were permanent, or at least permanent as of 2 years ago, you know, since this experience happened?
Yeah, I just feel like there's a level of self-consciousness that has reduced a huge amount. And like prior to this experience, I didn't have social anxiety, but I think I probably just had a normal, maybe a bit more normal level of like, I don't know, performance anxiety. Like I wanted to really perform highly in social interactions, and I cared what people thought of me a reasonable amount. And I worried about, you know, my sense of self and my performance in different areas, competitiveness with friends and that kind of stuff. And I think that although that stuff hasn't disappeared, I think it has reduced quite a lot. And in preparation for this interview, I wanted to put a number on this because I always find it annoying when you speak to people who have done a lot of meditation and the benefits they describe just don't sound very good. They just don't sound like worth the effort. So the number I came up with was, like, I think my suffering on average has reduced by 60%. And for me, that makes it all totally worth it.
That's very helpful. Yeah. So you've been on quite the journey, right, into meditation, and you've had ups and downs. Mm-hmm. What do you believe now about the path, right? So there were times when you doubted the path existed. There's some ways maybe you're skeptical about the path, but then you've also seen these really interesting, powerful experiences, and these, now you've had some lasting benefits. What's your current perspective?
Well, I think that meditation and mindfulness in particular can have huge benefits for your well-being. And I think the mechanisms of those benefits can vary. So on the one hand, you can just learn to regulate your emotions more skillfully, and there's nothing too profound about that. But I think if you sit, meditate, like long meditation retreats, you raise the probability that you're going to have some peak experience, which could be cessation, though that sounds very rare to me, or just, you know, like a self-transcendent experience. And I think that the benefits of that can endure. But I think what's of most interest to me right now is the non-dual path, which Sam Harris talks a lot about, because that, like, sitting long retreats just isn't really compatible with normal life. And this non-dual model of meditation and enlightenment is much more compatible. And the evidence base is basically I just trust Sam Harris, but I still can't do what he describes. But I think there's a there, and I'm trying to explore that, although it can be very frustrating.
So do you think you'll do these kind of 2-month meditations again, or 1 month or 3 months, in the tradition that you had got these profound benefits from? Or do you think that it's just not realistic with time investment?
Well, there's two components there. Like on the one hand, I have started working more now, so I'm kind of committed to living a normal life, at least for a while. So that makes it less likely. And then also there's some conflict between the non-dual and standard meditation paths, where a lot of non-dual teachers will tell you that you don't need to sit long retreats. And I feel like if I did sit another long retreat now, I might have that idea in my head and it could be distracting. But I mean, subjectively, like my evidence base of my own experience is that they have been very beneficial. So I might look at doing more, you know, one month retreats and see what happens from there.
Uh-huh. Well, also though, the whole like, oh, maybe 2 or 3% achieve stream entry, it's not exactly encouraging, right? So you've gotten all these benefits, but then in terms of getting to the next level, that might be, I don't know how that makes you feel, but.
I don't think I will get there, to be honest. Like, and one thing we haven't mentioned is that after that 1 month retreat, I went to Malaysia, did 5 weeks. And then a few months later, I went to Nepal, did a 3 month retreat. And, you know, I didn't have stream entry. And
Was it the same style, the 3 month retreat?
It was, but it was much more rigid. It was, they really wanted you focusing on your breath, as opposed to, it was not open awareness. So it wasn't the type of meditation that I gravitate towards.
So I can certainly see why you're looking for something quicker, because it's like, okay, you did this 1 month where you had these profound experiences and all these benefits, but then you also after that did a 3 month retreat that you didn't have as profound experiences and maybe you didn't get the same level of benefit. Is that right?
Well, I think the 3 month retreat for me was more just like honing the skill of mindfulness and like really kind of getting at the insight of impermanence, like just watching things change again and again and again. And I think that's really helped me to regulate my emotions.
Oh,
and
nice.
It's been hugely important.
So tell me about that. Like what was that benefit that you felt you got from the idea of impermanence?
Well, on the retreat, they're just telling you, especially in a certain stage that you go through, that they're telling you to pay attention to how long any experience lasts, whether it's positive or negative. And you can start to notice this change quicker and quicker and quicker, like to the point where, you know, towards the end of the retreat, I would be able to detect a bit of anxiety arise and disappear in like less than a second. Be like gone.
You're saying you would make it would like through your attention, the anxiety would disappear? Or are you saying that you're just observing that the natural state would be for it to appear and then disappear?
I think kind of both at times. Mm-hmm. I think if you pay closer attention, you might notice that it arises and passes away really quickly. And then I also think just by paying attention, you can make it go away. You can regulate it with mindful attention.
So that sounds useful. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and I had other experiences where I'd be, you know, suffering pretty intensely, like you say 7 out of 10 sadness. And then I would just pay attention to that sadness and do nothing else. And it would just kind of collapse and become like a 2 out of 10 sadness in the space of like a few seconds. And those are experiences that you don't even have. So I think there's a meta belief that's changed in my mind to some degree believing that negative feelings won't last as long as I previously did. And that's pretty helpful. But yeah, it is interesting to note that I didn't have any experiences as profound as that month-long retreat. And I hypothesized that it was because I wasn't investigating the sense of self, because that wasn't the technique. And I might be wrong about that. You know, maybe it's a stage I'm up to or something like that. But if I did a retreat again, I'd be interested in investigating the sense of self, because that seems to be at the heart of all of these different traditions.
Mm-hmm. And so I'm sure it's hard to pinpoint, but on the kind of 16 sub-stages prior to stream entry, what's your best guess about what stage you got to? Does it have a name? Does it have a description?
Yeah. So you can, like, the teachers, they might not want to give you a direct answer, but my teacher on the 3-month retreat alluded to the fact that I was up to equanimity, which is getting, you know, on the map, it's getting pretty close.
Getting pretty close to stream entry, basically.
Yeah. And I had one person tell me, you know, I was on the doorstep, but then I had my main meditation teacher tell me that that doorstep can be pretty long. So, like, subjectively, and, you know, you could argue, what do I know? But I didn't feel like I was getting close to anything profound.
Well, so you told me an interesting story about stage 4. Do you want to tell that again, just briefly? That very highest state?
Yeah. So stage 4 is, you know, full enlightenment. And I guess the most, this might be what you're referring to, but the most interesting thing I've heard about this from my main teacher is that he's never met anyone who has this stage. And for me, given how many people he's met and how much experience he's had, that's basically evidence that it's not possible to reach this stage. And so, you know, it's just not worth going for.
And he's at what, stage 3?
He'd probably hate me talking about this, but I assume he's at stage 3. Yeah.
Okay. We don't have to go into any detail, but but you know, one of the things that I find so striking about this is that there are these different schools of thought. Like, there are other approaches that they don't even have 16 stages at all, and they don't have 4 exactly major stages, and it's just like feels like it's almost a completely different system, right?
Yeah, and yet the technique is pretty similar. A lot of techniques are still focusing on the breath and you know, and that kind of thing. But yeah, the stages are different. I believe, like, I'm speaking off the top of my head, but I believe that there's some people, like academics, who try to kind of integrate the different paths, and it just didn't really work. It's just too complex.
Mm-hmm. So let's finish up talking about the non-dual techniques that you've been experimenting with more recently and that Sam Harris talks about. How do you think about what those are?
Yeah, well, I guess the premise of what you're trying to do is you're trying to recognize the way that your mind always already is. So you're not trying to cultivate a state. You're just trying to recognize something that is already there. And the claim is that, yeah, your mind is already selfless. It's already, there already is some type of well-being that is present, some kind of bliss, or something that's intrinsic to consciousness, and consciousness itself is separate from all its content. So even when you feel like you're depressed and your mind is completely contaminated by depression, consciousness is still distinct from that. And the common metaphor is, like, you know, the cloud versus the sky. Your sky is like consciousness. It's never damaged by the weather that's there. So the practice is just trying to get little glimpses of that, and the argument is that that can be the basis of all of your practice, and you don't need to do anything else because the relief is so profound. And yeah, like we've discussed, building a little document just to kind of track the most extreme ways that Sam Harris describes this, but it is extreme. Like he's basically saying that if you know this technique, you can access the same level of well-being that you would have when you're peaking on some blissful meditation experience as when you're in the pits of despair. Like if you can glimpse this thing, it's the same level of well-being. And it's very appealing to be able to have this ultimate unconditional source of well-being. But it just seems really hard to learn. And I don't know what the success rate is. It's hard to compare, but I imagine it's very low also. And I'd be very interested to start like surveying Sam Harris's, the users of waking up, if there's some way to do that, just to test, you know, the percentage of people who claim to have properly learned what he's talking about, not just conventional mindfulness, but non-dual mindfulness. And I suspect it's really, really low. And, you know, I've got friends who are just kind of fed up with it. I've definitely felt like that, but I really want to give it a fair crack. And I'm working with another teacher at the moment who teaches this way in a more gradual manner. So I guess I'll maybe can report back as I progress along that path.
Yeah, it's so interesting. So my understanding, tell me if I'm wrong, is that the idea with this kind of non-dual technique is not that you're going to sit for, you know, a month and meditate 12 hours a day, but more that you learn to get into this special mental state whenever you need it. So it's like you're in the pits of despair and you can jump into this mental state and it doesn't persist. It's not like you're going to stay in it for 2 hours. Maybe you're only going to stay in it for 2 seconds or something, but it's such a like state of bliss or perfection or something, or that even though it doesn't last for 2 hours, it somehow is still deeply helpful to you. And the fact that you can access it anytime you need, no matter how terrible things are, is like very powerful as well. Am I correct about that? Or you want to correct me?
Yeah, that's my understanding as well. You begin with small glimpses, like Locke Kelly talked about, small glimpses many times. And then, from what I understand, the more advanced people can stabilize it. And the goal is to have it completely stable, and certain people claim that's possible, but who knows? But it sounds like you don't even need to get to that point because it's so profound. Just knowing it's there and accessible brings a huge relief.
Right, and you can access it when you need it, hopefully.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, one of the things I find confusing hearing Sam Harris talk about this kind of stuff is sometimes it feels to me like he's just talking about an experience I've had many times during meditation, where it's just this sense of at that moment, oh, of course I'm not choosing what to think. Of course my thoughts are just occurring externally in some sense. And all I am is this thing that observes. And I say, of course, not because it's like sort of obvious, but just like a routine experience I have when I'm meditating. And it doesn't like, but sometimes it feels like he's talking about that thing and making it seem really deep and important. But then when you describe it as like the state of like, it almost sounds like a state of bliss or perfection that you can get into, then it doesn't, I don't relate to that at all. I don't know what you're talking about. So what do you think about this in terms of a regular meditative sit that someone has? Do you think that they're getting glimpses of this, or is this something different?
I'm conflicted, and I'd love to hear Sam Harris address this point, because on the one hand, he's describing this, you know, as the universal solvent. It's just like, and he's saying the level of psychological relief you can get is hard to exaggerate. So it just sounds insane, essentially. But then on the other hand, when he's talking about it, he can say, when you initially get it, it doesn't feel like much at all. And there are people who get it and they say, so what? And walk away and don't practice it. But it's hard to kind of piece those two together, because it seems like if it were that profound, then you get a taste of it and realize the benefits. And that's one challenge of a non-dual path, because you've also got the Douglas Harding crew who they teach this technique and this approach in a secular way. And their argument is, if you're sitting there and you just recognize that you can't see your own face, then you've got it. And some people are going to have peak experiences and some people won't, but everyone's got it. And it just doesn't seem, it just doesn't seem right to me.
Is that the headless way you're talking about?
Yeah, that's the headless way, yep.
Yeah, so could you describe that a little bit more about not seeing your own face?
Yeah, so you mean the background of it or the technique? Or?
Oh, the technique, like what are they referring to there?
Yes, so they're saying, you know, like especially using visual perception, that if you just pay attention to the fact that you can't see your own face or your own head, or you, even you imagine yourself without a head, then that can precipitate this insight that all these other non-dual traditions are talking about of selflessness, where you recognize that, yeah, the self isn't intrinsic to consciousness and your true identity is consciousness, as they say. But so many people will come to this technique, like I did, and just remain perplexed.
Right. It's like, so it's funny because I've tried that technique before. And when I do it, I'm like, yeah, I kind of think I get what he's saying. Like, I kind of feel like I'm in it, but that it does nothing profound to me. And then I'm like, okay, but maybe I'm just doing it wrong. And so, you know, I flip between there's nothing there and I'm doing it wrong. So I don't know.
That's basically my experience.
Yeah. It's funny. I think this is a common thing in meditation. It's like, how do you even know? It's like, if you don't get the profound experience, you're doing it wrong, but then nobody can explain what it is to do it right. And it's not necessarily their fault. I mean, obviously, that's the whole art of meditation teaching, right? It's like you're trying to describe these things that we don't, just literally don't have words for. Like, we don't have words for these internal experiences. And so, you know, we're making up metaphors and having people practice techniques and trying to very indirectly describe them, but it's just really slippery. And then, of course, we live in a world where some people are just frauds, right? And then it's like, at some point you're like, well, is this real or is this just this person bullshitting me? On the other hand, then there's you who has these profound experiences, which I think is, you know, suggests that, oh, okay, there really is something to be found, right? It's not all BS. So I think that's so fascinating. So the last thing I just want to end on is, for a lot of meditation traditions, the goal is enlightenment. And, you know, I think you came up with a really nice way to kind of define different versions of enlightenment. So I just wanted to finish there. Can you tell us about the different perspectives on what enlightenment is?
Yeah. So, and this is my understanding, I should premise, because I know that in Daniel Ingram's book, he's got like a list of like 20. So I think there's many more you could come up with. But from my understanding, there's the one we've mainly been discussing, which is the Theravada tradition, the four-stage model of enlightenment. And you go through these 16 substages, and then you hit cessation, and then you progress, and so on. And then these specific and permanent psychological changes occur, culminating in full enlightenment at stage 4, which I don't believe anyone has achieved. And then the second model is the one we were just talking about, of the non-dual traditions, where enlightenment is framed more as a temporary experience rather than a permanent thing that people achieve. So you're just trying to return to that state of enlightenment more and more, and until it becomes a stable state. And then the third model, I've never heard anyone define it in this way, but I've heard it described. And this is also, like the first one, a permanent model of enlightenment, but it doesn't require any cessation experience. It's more what like Eckhart Tolle and Ramana Maharshi describe of having a sudden peak self-transcendent experience. This seems to be often preceded by a fear of death, and then they have this huge self-loss experience, and then there's just a permanent change. So that's permanent as well. But it doesn't require cessation. So that's my little understanding of three models of enlightenment, and I'm sure people could come up with more.
Jeremy, this was awesome. Thanks so much for taking the time.
Thanks, Apes. That was really fun.
Thanks again for listening. If you have questions or comments, we'd love to hear from you. You can email us at clearerthinkingpodcast@gmail.com. Or you can call and leave us a voicemail at 321-341-4669. And by the way, if you do leave us a voicemail, we might use the audio on the show, which would be cool. Either way you contact us, we look forward to hearing from you. To find out more about Spencer, visit spencergreenberg.com. To find out more about Jeremy, take a look at his bio in the show notes. And to find out more about our show, visit clearerthinkingpodcast.com. If you like the show, we hope you'll rate and review us on whichever podcast store you used to subscribe to us. Thanks, and we'll see you next time.